Let me start by saying that the health sector prior to the 1990s was not viewed favorably by the financial sector. It was considered more as a liability rather than an investment. But this has dramatically changed since the 1990s. And the tipping point was a report written by the World Bank along with WHO in 1993, which was called Investing in Health. And this showed that investing in health has a lot of economic impact, not only for the communities who would be less burdened by healthcare costs, but more for the nation. And the major drivers which are addressing the shift is urbanization, as we talked about yesterday, globalization of lifestyles, and the change in people's living conditions, and climate change. Let me talk about some few first. For the first time in the history, there are more people who are 60 years old as compared to people less than 5 years old. This is the first time it has ever happened in the history. The second is an epidemiological shift, which means that there are more people today with what we call non-communicable diseases, which are lifestyle-related diseases, like diabetes, cancers, hypertension, strokes, and respiratory diseases, as compared to infectious diseases. In the past, people would die from diseases like cholera, AIDS, tuberculosis, but this has changed dramatically, and today there are two-thirds of the people are dying from non-communicable diseases. The third is an economic transition. As I mentioned, today there is more investment in health than ever before in the history. In the last decade, there are people like Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation who have provided tremendous amounts of input for health, and there are new financial instruments which have started in this decade. I'll mention two of them. One is called Gavi, which is the Global Alliance for Vaccine Investments. And this entity has provided for close to $10 billion in the last 10 years for countries to introduce new vaccines and to immunize their children. Another one is a fund called Global Fund for AIDS, TB and Malaria, which was set up in 2003, which has now distributed about $13 billion for health. In other words, people can, today, governments can buy these drugs at very cheap costs. Just to give you an example, when for the first time when antiretrovirals were discovered for AIDS, it cost about $10,000 to maintain a patient on antiretrovirals per month. Today, it costs about $100. So it is affordable for countries to buy this. So this is all being done because of new financial instruments which have been set up for health. The last point I'd like to make is there are more players in health today than ever before. There are many stakeholders, and this causes a lot of complexities in addressing health issues. Another big shift which has come for health has been the Millennium Development Goals. I want to talk a little bit about the Millennium Development Goals. These were 8 goals which were adopted in the year 2000 by 150 heads of states. The whole aim was to reduce poverty, and out of these, 3 goals were related to health. MDG 4 was to reduce child mortality, MDG 5 was to reduce maternal mortality, and MDG 6 was to address communicable diseases like AIDS, TB, and malaria. The whole idea of the Millennium Development Goals was to make this investment in these 8 goals so that countries would then be able to bring people out of poverty, and then they can manage to address their economic problems and go on to prosperity. So it was the reason why 3 goals were adopted for health is people knew that investing in health would make a more productive society and they would be more economically viable. And the second point to address child deaths was to ensure that a child would be able to study, would then be able to get gainful employment and then be able to be productive to the society. There's tremendous progress which has been made. Actually, you won't see it in the color coding, but there is only two of these targets which have not been met, which is in MDG 8, which is for essential medicines, and MDG 5, which is maternal mortality, meaning that much more investments need to be made to ensure that women are not dying from childbirth. However, in MDG 4, which is child mortality, immunizations, and in AIDS, TB, and malaria, there's a lot of progress which has been made. Just to give you a few statistics, under 5 mortality has been reduced almost by 50%, which means that today there are 17,000 fewer children dying every day as compared to the year 2000. That's tremendous. If 17,000 kids are being saved today, they are going to study and they are going to be a productive society. In the same way, maternal mortality has been decreased by 45%, which means that today we have less than 300,000 deaths annually as compared to 550,000 deaths in the year 2000. The same story with AIDS. Nobody believed that any country could maintain a patient with AIDS on antiretrovirals when it was first discovered. Today there are 13 million people on antiretrovirals, and 11 million of them are in Africa. And this is just unimaginable, because we are talking about countries which have a GDP growth of 2 to 3%, and they cannot afford it. But because of instruments like Global Fund, they are able to afford this costly medicine and ensure that people don't die from AIDS. Same story with malaria. 37 million lives have been saved in the past 15 years, and 4.3 million deaths have been averted, and the same story for TB. This is a very interesting slide. I think we see it here. This is universal health coverage. Universal health coverage is a concept where everybody needs to be treated by the state government, and nobody should be having lack of services because of their age, because they are elderly or child, or because of their sex, or because of their socioeconomic status. So in every parameter, you can see that there has been some growth, starting from the year 2000 to the year 2012, when we have the latest statistics. So this is improved water, which has gone almost close to 90%. The next one is immunizations, which has almost gone more than 80% coverage. That means 80% of the kids are being covered by the 6 vaccines. So they will have less diphtheria, less tuberculosis, less tetanus, and so on. And if you look at skilled birth attendants, these are women who are being, pregnancy is being overseen by somebody who's trained, rather than a traditional birth attendant. And this has gone almost to 80%. So in every parameter, you can see that there has been some increase. Now, at the same time, unfortunately, you see a lot of emergencies on health. And you can classify it into 4 sections. One is natural, which is earthquakes, landslides, tsunamis, and so on. But the second one, which happens for the health sector quite often, is epidemics. And I'll talk about this a little bit more. The third one is technological, which means chemicals and radiological contaminants. And the last one is societal, mainly conflicts and stampedes. Now, unfortunately, each of these incidents have a significant impact on health. And I showed you all the gains which have been made in the last 15 years in health. Any of these things which happen will have a detrimental effect and a loss of the gains which have been made in health and in other sectors. And this is the unfortunate thing with the emergency. So all these difficult processes and interventions in order to improve health will be set back by any of these emergencies which happen. And I'll give you some examples of that. Just to show you the magnitude of this problem, there have been 700 emergencies from natural hazards which have had a detrimental effect on 200 million people in the year 2000 alone. And these are recorded by the global statistics. And for each of these emergencies, there are 20 which are not recorded. In other words, there are local epidemics which are happening, or local emergencies which are happening, which are not recorded and still have an impact upon local communities. Just in the last 12 months, we have seen the Ebola crisis, we have seen MERS, which we talked about yesterday, and we see H1N1, and I'll give you some statistics on how this is impacting upon health. Now, how can it impact upon health? First is the direct impact. There is loss of lives, there's injuries, there's disabilities, but more importantly, psychosocial problems. I think most of us know about PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, and everybody knows that this is not something which can be solved in a day or two. These are people who have lost their livelihoods. For instance, in the tsunami, there are so many fishermen who have lost their livelihoods, cannot regain their employment, and they have plenty of psychosocial problems which have to be addressed. Again, it's not a one-year issue, it's a long-term effect which happens. People have lost their assets, household assets and so on. They need to be rehabilitated, and it's not easy. People have lost their loved ones, will have tremendous psychosocial problems. The second is an indirect effect, which is the disruption of health services. So that people who are injured not only have to be cared, but those who are having other ailments, like chronic ailments like diabetes or hypertension, have to be taken care of. And access to health facilities are not that easy during times of disasters. Now, what is the supply chain risk? Firstly, it is the facilities which can be disrupted. Supplies and equipment can also be damaged. And it's very difficult to get chronic dialysis machines very quickly in health facilities which are suffering from lack of electricity and so on. And more importantly, drug supplies can be damaged. The second big problem is the labor force. Labor force is not that easy, and particularly in the rural areas, to have qualified, trained people who can respond effectively and very quickly. And in order to ensure that we can have a business continuity plan, we need to think of service continuity plans. It was easy, as we heard yesterday, that people could be from the banking sector could be involved, and they could follow a set of guidelines, a set of checklists. That's not the same in the health services. You have to cater for individual needs. Every patient is different, and every patient needs a different approach. And that cannot be easily addressed by a checklist. So how do you manage these health risks? First is vulnerability reduction. So we need to invest in ensuring that there is a service continuity plan. The second one is to respond during immediate needs. And the third one is recovery. Now, all of this is a cyclical process. So even when you're responding, you need to think of recovery measures, and I'll give you an example of that. Now, when you talk about a resilient health system, the first is the surge capacity. So you have a large number of patients who need to be taken care of, and you need mobilization of medical teams. Now, medical teams may need to come from other sources. Probably in Korea, you know that there was a big, large medical team which was coming to do the investigation in MERS. So it cannot be done sometimes by the country because they don't have the expertise. The expertise lies elsewhere, and therefore they need to get that expertise from outside. The second is being flexible to do different functions and reducing some services but increasing others. So normal services could be reduced, things like planned surgeries can be reduced, but things which need to be increased are emergency surgeries and so on. And the last one is continuity plans, and this requires coordination and communications with several partners and the staff. So what are the major lessons we have learned? We have learned that health sector cannot be approached simply by one sector alone. We've got to have water and sanitation. Now, if hospitals are destroyed, if you don't have adequate water and sanitation, it's going to create more problems. It's going to cause more epidemics. You have to worry about a cholera epidemic. You have to worry about a dengue epidemic or whatever, which is not related to the disaster, but could happen when you don't have an adequate water and sanitation. You need to have security. You need to have communications and logistics. You need to have energy. You've got to get generators operating so that people can have emergency surgeries. And you need to pay people for what they do. In what we learned from Ebola, there are so many people willing to volunteer, but if they are not paid, they will not provide adequate services. So you need to have some mechanism. There was money available. The bank mobilized about $500 million to provide immediate funds to the Ebola-affected countries. But somebody has to give that money. It sits because there were no possibilities to get banks in Liberia and in Guinea. The second most important thing is that you need to start the response with the community and then end the response with the community. If you don't have the local knowledge, you cannot provide local actions. This is a very important lesson which we learned in most of the epidemics. If you don't know the language, if you don't know the culture, you can bring a lot of foreign medical teams and they will be totally ineffective. People will not accept the services. The last thing is, of course, I talked about the health systems. And here, I just want to say that different kinds of people are required for managing a disaster situation. There needs to be surgeons who need to provide trauma care. There needs to be epidemiologists or people who can count numbers and know what to do. There need to be social scientists. There need to be anthropologists who understand the local conditions, logisticians, lab personnel, administrators, and so on. A team doesn't just consist of healthcare personnel. You need to have many other sectors involved in order to provide the services. For instance, in Sierra Leone and Liberia, there needed to be the US Army and the British Army to come and put Ebola treatment centers. Nobody else could provide it. Healthcare could not have provided it. Construction company couldn't have provided it. Therefore, Obama had to agree in the Congress to send 4,000 army personnel to go and build 1,500-bedded treatment units in Liberia in order to contain people so that they will not spread the infection. I want to talk a little bit about the Ebola epidemic because it's fresh in our minds. It's so many learning lessons. And the baseline is that in this country, there were 1 to 2 physicians per 100,000 population, already starting very low. And out of this, 800 healthcare workers were infected with Ebola because they are the ones who are treating the people immediately. They didn't know that it was Ebola in the first place. They got infected and they died. 500 of them died. So you can start with a low baseline, and then many of the doctors died, and many of them are pathologists and surgeons. And imagine the type of surge capacity which is required in order to provide any kind of services. Today, a year into the epidemic, we have about 1,000 WHO staff on the ground in these three countries. Although Liberia doesn't have any more cases, you still have to maintain surveillance. Because if you're not vigilant, it can come back again. Similar to what happened, that one person skipped quarantine with MERS and went off to Japan, and he was diagnosed in Japan. Another one went from Oman to Thailand and was admitted in the hospital with MERS. So if you're not vigilant, you will start another epidemic in the country. Another example which I want to give you, which is just happening right now, is the Nepal earthquake. And there are 150 humanitarian organizations providing services there. 150. Now you can imagine the coordination which is required in order to manage all this. And there are 130 foreign medical teams operating in the country. So this is the scale of the operations which are taking place in disasters. I'll talk a little bit more because this is a fantastic example of what can happen when you're not prepared. It was a mysterious disease which started in December 2013 in a little village in Guinea. Unfortunately, the village was very close to the borders of Liberia and Sierra Leone. Nobody knew what this disease was. It took about 3 months in order for it to be identified as Ebola. Now, people thought that it was a hemorrhagic fever, and they thought it was Lassa fever, which had occurred in West Africa. They never thought it was Ebola because Ebola had never been in West Africa. So nobody thought about it. When it was eventually identified, at that time there were 49 cases and 29 deaths, all in one country, in Guinea. Because people did not take adequate measures, and it was very unfortunate because traditionally, when somebody dies in those circumstances, they do 1 week of mourning. In other words, they wash the bodies, and the women are supposed to wash the bodies. And in this case, in hemorrhagic fever, what happens is that the spread of the virus is from the body fluids. So when you spend time to wash the saliva and so on and the blood, you contract the virus yourself, and this is how it spread. And today it's a much more different issue because people move so much across borders, and they move because of trade and other issues to the capital cities. So very quickly it went into 3 countries and it went into the capital cities. 40 years of history from Ebola, it has never been in the capital cities. So it was always contained in the rural areas and a small outbreak, and it would be managed in 4 to 6 months. In August, WHO had to have an emergency committee, and it was declared as an outbreak of international public health emergency. And once we knew that there were no doctors and no facilities to contain people, because in infectious diseases, what you need to do is to identify cases quickly and more or less quarantine them. You have to cordon them off from anybody else. And that was not possible because all of these hospitals were full of Ebola patients. And there was nobody else wanted to go there, because if a pregnant woman wanted to deliver, she wouldn't go there because she's scared to get Ebola. If somebody had measles or cough, they were not being able to go to any other facilities. And this is where other governments had to chip in and go and build Ebola treatment centers. So it became a larger issue, and the UN had to make an intervention, and the UN Security Council, only for the second time in the history of the UN, discussed health. It was unprecedented that in September 2014, just before the General Assembly, there was a Security Council meeting, and for the first time ever, there was a UN emergency operation for health. Now, most of the UN operations are for security purposes. You might know that today there's an operation in Yemen. In the past, there have been operations in Libya and so on, in Haiti. But for the first time, there was a UN emergency health mission, which was commissioned after 2 discussions in the General Assembly and adoption of a Security Council resolution. Now again, this is unprecedented, because in Security Council, usually there is never a unanimous vote. And all the 15 Security Council members unanimously adopted that resolution with 134 co-sponsors. 134 countries co-sponsored it. And then, because most of the flights were being stopped in these 3 countries, an air bridge had to be opened. And the Secretary General then contacted the President of Ghana, and he opened Accra as an air bridge where supplies and equipment could be brought and then taken to the other 3 countries. Again, personnel couldn't fly because the only airline which was flying was the Belgian carrier, Brussels Airlines. All the other airlines stopped flying to these 3 countries. So even getting supplies and equipment and personnel was very difficult. Cuba sent 200 doctors immediately, but they had to fly to Accra and then be sent to the other 3 countries. I won't go into this because this is more technical. This is all typical of how you stop the epidemic. But one thing I wanted to say is that preserving the stability is crucial, because you must understand that these three countries came from 12 to 14 years of civil strife in the past. And all of them were recovering from this civil strife. And for 10 years there was a growth, but still there was lack of trust within the government. And when the government said something that don't move, the people started chaotically behaving. Because you can tell people don't move, but if you don't provide them water and food, where will they go? So this is the problem. The government didn't have adequate food and water to provide for these people, and then they started having a lot of security problems and rioting and so on in the streets. And this was in the capital cities, unfortunately. Another thing we had to do was to prevent further outbreaks, because we were concerned that the other West African countries would have the problem. And three other West African countries had the problem. So somebody went from Liberia to Nigeria and was diagnosed there. But fortunately, that was well contained. Another same problem happened in Mali. And this also required a lot of unnecessary chaos in those countries. Now, the strategy, which was the UN strategy, was quite interesting. The first thing we did in the phase one was to build treatment centers, so where people could be contained. The second one was to bury the diseased, and to bury it in a non-traditional way. And I want to emphasize this because, as I mentioned, nobody likes their loved ones to be taken to the ground without paying the due respects. Now imagine somebody coming with a mask, with all this hazmat suit, and putting them into a plastic bag and taking the dead away. Nobody will agree to it. So they started hiding the dead. So we had to go and educate the community that please allow us to do this public health measures, you know, and build the community trust again. Because if the community doesn't believe in what you're doing, they will try to hide. They will try to go away to another country and seek services there. So the first phase was the three B's, which were building treatment centers, burying the dead, and building community trust. But after we got over this, the next step was to engage the community in providing the services. So there were many people who didn't die, they survived, but then they were not brought back to the community. Nobody would touch them anymore. Nobody would hug them anymore. So we had to use them as the health personnel, more or less. So building trust and engaging them into the community activities so they can be part of the response rather than being shunned away from society. The second thing we did was contact tracing. In other words, the incubation period is 21 days. So from the time you contract the disease, you're infectious for 21 days. So you need to go back 21 days to see with whom you have been in contact. And that's not easy. In order for you to go and test those people with whom you've been in contact and contain them. And the third part was the case management. So the strategy changed after the first phase, and the second phase was getting the communities to be involved. I'll skip this. And what are the key lessons learned? Today, we are living in a world where we cannot say that it's a local epidemic anymore. Unfortunately, diseases spread, they don't have passports, and they don't have immigration and so on. And cross-border spread is something which we need to be worried about. So international cooperation is crucial. Number two is you've got to involve the community. If you don't involve the community, you will go nowhere, as I mentioned. The third is to strengthen the health systems in order to cope for a disaster. So if you don't have a strong health system, I mentioned to you three countries in Africa which have a weak infrastructure, you will not get very far. And the last one is the partnerships. And this is crucial because when the UN started this commission, they wanted $115 million for immediate response. And within 3 weeks, almost $1.4 billion was raised completely. Countries like Equatorial Guinea, a small country, they provided $2 million. So this was the kind of solidarity which was there. And on the right-hand side, you can see that there were so many outputs For instance, there were 2,000, more than 2,000 emergency treatment centers with beds as compared to 548. This is a four-time increase in about 4 months. And this is incredible amount of solidarity and help from the international community. 26 labs were set up in these three countries in order to do case detection. There were zero labs before that. So these countries didn't have the capacity to do the testing. So these are the kind of outputs which were provided by this international solidarity. So my conclusion is that however much a country can deal with its own issues, you've got to have international support during these emergency times. Many times they don't have the expertise and you have to build the expertise from other countries. Of course, national commitment needs to be there. You've got to strengthen your regulation. There is something known as the International Health Regulation, which was adopted in 2005. But in the ASEAN countries, apart from Korea, probably Thailand and Indonesia have that capacity to a certain extent, but most of the other countries don't have that capacity. In other words, you need to have labs to detect infectious diseases. You need to have personnel who are trained to do that. This may involve some amount of redundancy, but this is where investment in health costs matters. You may not need them for 5 years, but still you need to maintain that expertise in your own country. If you don't have that, you will not be able to detect new viruses which are coming up. The last thing I want to say is that recovery operations need to start immediately as soon as you start the response. So just to give you an example, these three countries have gone from a GDP growth of 8 to 9% to less than 2.5% in 6 months. So these were projections by IMF and World Bank. Where is the recovery going to happen from? It's not from the health sector alone. It's got to be the education sector, because kids have lost 8 months, 8 to 9 months of schooling. Agriculture sector has lost because people were not working anymore. They were not allowed to go to the fields. Security has been a problem. So all the gains which these three countries have made have been lost back. Nobody knows what the economic consequences are in the future. There are studies being done today. But in principle, the world has made about $4 billion investment so far. And next week, on July 9th and 10th, there is a major meeting in the UN to talk about the recovery, an 18-month recovery plan. These three governments wanted to have something known as a Marshall Plan for recovery, but I think they start with an 18-month plan in order to say how much investments need to be made and who's going to make those investments. So I'll stop here.